Welcome to lecture number 17, NPTEL online certification course on bioreactors. In the previous lecture, we solved a problem, the practice problem 4.1. In the lecture before that, we had looked at certain bioreactor environment variables that affect bioreactor performance, such as temperature, pH, medium composition, agitation aeration levels and dissolved oxygen levels. These are crucial and so they need to be properly measured and controlled. We looked at some aspects of that. In the previous lecture, we looked at the lecture before the problem. We looked at the dissolved oxygen aspect. While talking about the DO probe, there was some slight confusion there. That is because of an error here. The cathode is platinum and anode is silver. I think I had mixed it around last time. Otherwise, it's all the same. So, the cathode is platinum, anode is silver. Then, let us move forward. I think we had looked at this practice problem 4.1 and solution and so on. We will move forward from here. When we talked about agitation and aeration, we had said that both affect DO as well as they cause shear stress in cells. What exactly is shear stress? If you have done a course on fluid mechanics, you would already know, but that does not matter. Depending on your background, you may or may not have done it. Let us understand shear stress this way. Let us take a ball of chapati dough, roti dough, and place that dough ball between the palms of your hands, right? Something like this. And then when we slightly press and move the palms in opposite directions, what happens to the ball? Right? The ball does get distorted, right? The chapati dough does get distorted. The ball distorts due to the shear forces exerted by the palms when they are moved in opposite direction. There are forces acting on the surface of the chapati dough ball which distorts it, and such forces are called shear forces. They are surface forces. In other words, when there is a relative velocity between the two palms, this palm is moving in this direction, this palm is moving in this direction, or it could be both moving in the same direction but at different velocities. As long as there is a relative velocity between the two palms, the dough ball that is caught in between is going to experience shear stress, which could deform the dough ball there. In a fluid environment, such as in a bioreactor, relative velocities or velocity gradients exist in abundance. Velocity gradients means the difference in velocity with a certain distance. It is the derivative with respect to the distance of the velocity, d dx of v, d dy of v, and so on. So, those are velocity gradients. As long as there are velocity gradients, there is going to be shear stress, and the cells are going to experience shear stress. So, shear stress is a given in the case of a bioreactor environment, fluid environment, where there are a lot of velocity gradients. The velocity gradients are brought about because the fluid is moving. The fluid is moving because of the agitator that is present there, or the agitation that is being caused, or the aeration that is being employed. The aeration also displaces the fluid, it causes velocity gradients, therefore, it can cause shear stress. So, aeration and agitation cause velocity gradients and hence shear stress in bioreactors. Bubble breakage, the air bubble breakage, could also cause damage, but the damage is through a different mechanism, that is through the energy released due to bubble breakage. In terms of shear stress, aeration and agitation cause shear stress because they cause velocity gradients in the bioreactor. So, we need to worry about the shear stress. Some cells, such as the mammalian cells, animal cells, do not have a cell wall and therefore they could be more susceptible to shear stress. some cells, because they have a shear wall, they could be less susceptible. All these are maybe not, because even if you have a cell wall, you could have a lot of shear stress effects, because the cell wall is rigid, it does not allow easy motion, and if the contents inside need to move freely and the cell wall does not allow it, that can also cause stress. So shear stress, all cells experience shear stress in bioreactors. Some are able to withstand shear stress to a certain extent, some are not able to, and we need to be aware of that, because that would determine whether the bioreactor is going to turn out successful or not. Having said that, let us look at scale up of bioreactors. What does scale up mean? When a process is developed, it is usually developed at a small scale, lab scale first, maybe in a shake flask and so on, and then in a bioreactor, maybe a 1 liter, 2 liter bioreactor, and maybe in the lab itself, if you have a 10, 20 liter bioreactor, there is a tenfold scale up that is happening there. What was found at the small scale of 1 liter must be translatable to a large scale. That is what is meant by scale up. Things need to be ensured, the scale up needs to be ensured, otherwise the process may not be viable at the industry level, where the scale up could be many orders of magnitude. The industrial reactors, as we saw, could be 1 lakh, 2 lakh reactors, 2 lakh liter reactors and so on. The lab scale is 1 liter. So the scale up is an important aspect of bioreactors. We look at some aspect of those. They are of course developed at a small scale because of the cost. We don't even know whether the process is going to work. So to minimize costs involved, even medium is expensive. The processes are developed first at small scale. So, as mentioned, how can one make them work at large scale when many crucial aspects could be different from the small scale where they were made to work or where they were demonstrated to work? The scale up is done by keeping certain parameters at the large scale the same as the ones that were effective at the small scale. So, appropriate parameters at the large scale are kept as the same as the effective ones at the small scale. These are called scale up criteria. During scale up criteria, we cannot choose anything and have that as a scale up criteria. We cannot say that the diameter of the impeller should be the same, then it will not work, right? We shouldn't say that probably the shaft diameter should be the same. That doesn't make any sense. So, appropriate things need to be the same at two levels, at the small scale as well as at the large scale. What is normally seen is equivalence of geometric parameters, as they are called, and equivalence of operational parameters. And to show both these, or to look at the very surface level information on these, let us take the example of a stirred tank. First, the geometric similarity. When there is a stirred tank, okay, this is the stirred tank, the rectangle, actually it is a cylinder, this is a stirred tank. This is the impeller, and this is impeller shaft, impeller blades. The various dimensions are given here. Di is the diameter from the tip of one impeller to the tip of a diametrically opposite impeller. W is the width of the impeller, L is the length of the impeller blade, C is the distance from the bottom of the tank to the middle of the impeller, if only one set is used. We will just take this as an example. D is the diameter of the vessel, H is the height of the liquid in which the vessel is kept, and B is what is called a baffle. Baffle, typically there are about 4 or 6 baffles. Baffles are employed because you know what happens when you rotate a liquid, when you use an impeller to rotate a liquid, there is a vortex that gets formed. Therefore, the liquid will be something like this on top. That is not very desired. To stop the vortex formation, if you have strips, thin strips, there are about four strips at opposite diameters, those strips, metal strips, can stop this vortex formation. That's the function of this baffle. So for geometric similarity, these are the ones that are considered. The height to the diameter ratio must be 1. In the case of stirred tanks, these are very standard ones. You could take this down. The h by d should be 1. The di, the impeller diameter tip to tip, divided by the tank diameter should be 1/3. Di by d is 1/3. B, the baffle thickness divided by the diameter of the tank is 1/12. This should be maintained constant at the small scale as well as at the large scale for geometric similarity. C, which is the distance from the bottom of the impeller, bottom of the tank to the impeller middle, to the diameter, the ratio should be 1/3. Also, W, the width of the impeller blade divided by the impeller diameter, should be 1/5. And L, the length of the impeller blade by the impeller diameter, should be 1/4. So there are four criteria based on normalized with the tank diameter, the height, height to h by d, di by d, b by d, and c by d. And there are two that are based on the impeller diameter, w by di 1/5 and l by di is 1/4 here. So, as long as these two things are maintained the same, these are chosen both at the small scale and at the large scale, we will have geometric similarity. For the operational similarity, we look for maintaining a constant KLA. We looked at KLA, and it is also an important scale up parameter. We look for maintaining a constant volumetric mass transfer coefficient or KLA at the small and the large scales. We look for constant power consumption per unit volume P by V. We look for constant tip, impeller tip speed. Impeller tip, you know, impeller diameter is DI, that is a diameter. Pi d would be the circle which it makes out, the distance that is traveled, times n, the RPM, the speed of the impeller, that gives you the variable that you need to keep constant at the lower level and at the higher level, higher scale, that is. And also, one looks for constant dissolved oxygen concentration and constant Reynolds number in the bioreactor. Okay. The industry, and in fact quite a few are looked at, these are the common ones. This paper by Garcia, Ochoa and Gomes in 2009, this was published in Biotechnology Advances. The title is Bioreactor Scale-Up and Oxygen Transfer Rate in Microbial Processes, an Overview. This says that in the industry, typically the scale-up is done on a KLA basis 30% of the time, on a constant power consumption per unit volume basis 30% of the time, constant impeller tip speed 20% of the time, constant DO value 20% of the time. Okay, that is typically the chosen parameters for scale up in the industry. The equivalence of micro environment at the two scales is rather difficult. You know, we know that the cells are the actual factories that produce the product, and therefore the micro environment or the environment of each cell needs to be kept the same for expecting the same level of performance, same kind of performance at these two levels. This is rather difficult. So, the criteria usually work, but they do not work all the time. So, we need to be wary of that and hope that it works. If it doesn't work, we need to go and understand things at the cell level. In fact, that is what the next module is all about. This provides some reasoning for understanding things at the micro level, even from an industry point of view. Microenvironment is important, as we mentioned, because cells, the actual factories, are influenced by the microenvironment. The scale-up is still an art. It's not fully understood even today, and more work needs to be done to be able to bring it down to a firm science. We talked of scale-up, scale-down. Okay, it might sound a little odd initially, because usually you hear of scale-up, not scale-down. But scale-down is also important in bioreactors. It's something like this. We are already operating at the large scale. We need to do some changes to improve the process at the large scale, but they might be stuck for production, for they might be used continuously for production. So you cannot do experiments at the large scale. And typically, you don't want to spend so much money in doing these experiments also. What if the experiment doesn't work? Then you'd have lost the entire cost associated with trying out that experiment. So what is done is, the things are built at the small scale to represent the large scale. And then experiments could be done at the small scale with the confidence that they would work at the large scale. And then you could implement them at the large scale. So scale down is also an important aspect in bioreactors. To study potential strategies to improve an existing process, changes in medium composition, for example, even a new batch of the same ingredients is tested at the scale down level. Newer modified production strains are first tried down at the scale down level. Operating conditions such as inoculum levels, anti-foam use, dissolved oxygen level, etc. are tried out. And validation of new operating procedures for cell culture products without taking time off from the production reactor. In all these situations, scale down becomes important. So, and faster screening of multiple strategies in many miniature bioreactors at the same time also becomes possible if an effective scale down has been made. So you screen various things at small reactors. They've all been exposed to a representative set of conditions at the large scale, and then it can be there is more confidence associated with the results from a scaled down process, especially at the industry level. There are two papers here that I would like to point out. These are given in your reference document. The number 27 is on scale up. This we talked about, Garcia Ochoa. 28 is on bioreactor scale down, Palomares et al., Palomares, Lara, and Octavio Ramirez. 2010 bioreactor scale down in the Encyclopedia of Industrial Biotechnology. And the validation viewpoint in scale down has been given on in this website. You can go and check out this website. I think that's it for module 4. In module 4, we looked at the effect of certain bioreactor environment parameters on the bioreactor cultures and thereby the bioreactor performance. The ones that we looked at were temperature, pH, medium composition, agitation and aeration levels, and dissolved oxygen level. Dissolved oxygen level we looked at in some depth. Then we also looked at scale up and scale down of bioreactors in module 4. So when we meet again in when we meet next, we will take up module 5, which will be the last module for this course. See you then.